Lord, as we look at tonight's message, we thank you that as we enter into spiritual warfare, it is not something that you leave us abandoned to, that, Lord, we don't have without ability to fight. Lord, we thank you for the spiritual armor that we've talked about. We thank you that we can be aware of the schemes of the enemy, that we don't have to be blindsided. Father, we thank you for the allies and the angelic forces. And Lord, we thank you that when the war is over, we get to be in your presence. We are so humbled by that awesome privilege. Lord, help us to get a glimpse of what that looks like tonight. We ask this in your name. Amen. Some of you recognize that picture. That is one of the most famous pictures after World War what?
Two.
So these guys are coming down, and all of a sudden this Navy guy comes up and he sees this nurse, doesn't even know her, just grabs her, plants one on her. This is not a picture of me. I know some of you are thinking, gosh, that goes way back. That could be Pastor Mike and his wife. But what this is, you know, when we go through tough challenges, and we come to the end, it's time to celebrate. And that's what this is. You see a celebration that was caught memorial as far as what the United States is concerned in World War II. And when we've talked about this war series, we've talked about the fight, we've talked about the battles. You saw in the video, sometimes we have to lean on each other through those spiritual battles, and we have to be that for each other. You know, for some of you, you've gone through challenges, right? And you've celebrated, not quite like this, but when you've graduated, right, you take your hat off, you're throwing that up there, you're completing a huge work project. You and your team, you go out and you celebrate, you have a big old dinner together. Some of you finish an endurance race, you collapse at the line, you hold your hands up, you feel like you're a superstar until you fall on your face afterwards, right? Some of you, it's handing in your dissertation. You're like, oh, years and years, boom, I hit my head. And so you're completing that battle there. For many of you, right now, your big battle, your big war, is just finishing your Christmas shopping, okay? That's just your war right now. But when the battle ends, for certain, the rest that we experience at the end of the battle is sweet. When you come to the end of their life, when you come to the end of your life as a believer, and there's no more battle with sin, there's no more battle with shame, there's no more battle with the frustrations of this world or the weaknesses of your body, and you come to the perfect rest of God's kingdom and his eternal life, it's going to be an awesome thing. It's going to go way beyond what this kiss is. Now, I know some of you need to go off this because some of you are thinking about who you want to kiss right now. So let's go ahead and flip to that next slide. Yes, the war is over. Some of you in the war right now is, who am I going to kiss, okay? But the new heaven and the new earth that we talk about. Last week we talked about the heaven, and we talked about if you die right now as a believer, you immediately, you're be absent from your what? Absent from your body and present with the Lord. Okay, so what happens is you're separated from your body, but your spirit is immediately with the Lord. And then at the resurrection, your body will meet your spirit, and you'll have a new resurrected body for the eternal heaven. So if you die right now, you don't go to the eternal heaven. You go to what we call the present heaven. What Jesus called paradise when he was talking to the thief on the cross. What the Hebrews refer to as Abraham's bosom, Abraham's side, Abraham's heart. And you were there temporarily, and then, but it's a long time for us now. But in light of eternity, it's temporary. And then the new heaven and the new earth are going to be ushered in. So turn in your Bibles to Revelation 21 and 22. Revelation chapter 21 and 22. The new heaven and the new earth will be God restoring the earth to its original condition. It's going to look like Genesis 1 and 2, but even better. It's going to be royal. There's going to be no pollution, no waste, no abuse, no selfishness, no sin. Just truth and peace and harmony between the Creator and us as His creation. We're going to gladly praise our God and stand amazed in His gracious love. And we're going to treat each other with the same unconditional love that God treats us. That's going to be a good place. That would be just heaven in itself right there, right? If we treated each other in unconditional love like God treated us, that would just be heaven right there, period. We're going to be living in the presence of God, and that's going to be incredible. So Revelation 21 and 20 through 22, 5 describes an eternal place called a new heaven and new earth, where believers will live eternally. And after we've gone to the present heaven, after the final judgment, we're going to be established in the new heaven and new earth, and there's going to be the holy, royal version of the original created earth of Genesis 1 and 2. That's the new heavens and the new earth. So, in your outlines and your bulletins, first thing we're going to see here in Revelation 21 is that all things are going to be made new. All things are going to be made new. Revelation 21, verse 1 and 2 says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and earth passed away." So the earth that we're on now and the present heaven are going to pass away. God's going to recreate the heaven and recreate the earth. And actually, He's going to bring it down. And it says, "And there's no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for husband." So it's going to be really out with the old and in with the new. The earth that you know right now is going to be no longer. God's going to reshape it, and it's going to reshape it with fire, and it's going to recreate it. The present heaven and earth is going to be upgraded. Many of you are into upgrades, right? My contract's expired. Do I upgrade my new phone? I upgrade my computer. God is basically going to upgrade this earth. He's going to reform it. He's going to reshape it. He's going to upgrade it, and then He's going to combine it with the new heaven, and it's going to be one place. So you see, it's coming down out of heaven, and it's made ready as a bride adorned for a husband. And then after that new presentation, next point we see in verse 3 and 4 is there's a new relationship. A new relationship. In verse 3 it says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men.'" That means the dwelling place of God. "And He will dwell among them, and they shall be His people. And God Himself will be among them. And He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will no longer be any death, and there will no longer be any mourning, or crying, or pain. The first things have passed away." And we're going to talk about that, because in this translation, it says the first things have passed away. Other ones a little bit different. But verse 3, we would look at, is that He will dwell among His people. God is going to dwell right with us. He is going to dwell right with us. Now, if you look in Genesis 1 through 3, in chapter 3, Adam and Eve were walking around in the garden, right? And right after Adam and Eve were walking around the garden, they sin, right? And after they sin, they were afraid. They got caught. They knew that they were wrong. They put on their pajamas. No, they were naked. They were ashamed, okay? And God said, "Who told you that you're naked?" Right? Because God was walking around in the garden too. And that's what's going to happen in here in a Genesis, I mean in Revelation 3, is God is going to be walking amongst us. It's not going to be God in heaven in a faraway, unique place. God can be anywhere he wants right now, but he has a unique place called heaven that he dwells in that we don't get to be in right now, presently. But in the new heaven, new earth, God is going to be walking around among us. He's going to dwell right amongst us, as we see in verse 3. And it's going to be like what God originally intended in Genesis 1 and 2 before the fall of mankind. There's going to be a personal intimacy. You are going to be able to interact and be face to face with God in a way that we have never experienced here. And he's going to take care of our hearts like no other. We're not going to suffer anymore. You know, here in verse 4, it says that, you know, the first things have passed away. But in the NIV, it says the old order of things have passed away. And that's what we're talking about. The New King James, the former things, the NLT, all things are gone forever. Basically, the tears, the pain, the suffering, the dying. Usually, when we have somebody in our life that passes away, we go to this passage, right? And we'll say, you know, there's going to be no more death, no more pain, no more tears. And I'm not saying that won't happen in the present heaven, that if I die right now, but this passage is specifically talking about in the future, eternal heaven, where the new heaven and new earth is established together. That's what this passage is really talking about. And so that's one thing we can be for sure of, that God has for us. Well, there's not only going to be those things, there's going to be a new work. Point three, God's got a new work. In verse 5 and 6, it says, he who sits on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Again, that's why it's called the new heavens and the new earth. And he said, write these words, write, for these words are faithful and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha, which means the first, and the Omega, which is the last, the beginning and the end. I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of the water of life without cost. This new heaven and earth, this is God's new thing. He is faithful and true, and you can count on it. He is the beginning of all things. That means he's the Alpha. So anything new in your life, he can be the beginning of. He's the end of all things. He's the Omega. In the end, he's going to restore all things like he originally created in the beginning of time. So this new heaven and new earth, as I've mentioned already, is going to be, hey, you sinned. Adam and Eve sinned in the first place. They kind of messed up the earth that I originally intended. I'm bringing it back to the original intention. And that's what this new heaven and new earth are. And you guys are going to experience it. You know, we've always said, gosh, I wish I could have been there in Eden where it was perfect. Well, you're going to get to be there in the new heaven and the new earth. And then you're going to drink the blessings. Because it says, I will give to one who thirsts from the spring of water without life, the spring of water of life without cost. You get to drink the blessings of God without cost. It says without cost. Why is it without cost? Who paid the cost? Jesus Christ paid the cost so you and I can drink freely. You know, it's not going to, we go to a fair, they charge us $2 for a bottle of water, right? You're like, bottle of water for $2. No, you're going to be drinking living water. It's going to be the best stuff, and it's going to be without cost because the cost has been paid by Jesus Christ. And so it's a new work. God does something new. And then in verse 7, we have a new inheritance. It says, he who overcomes will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. If you overcome, what does it mean to overcome? Overcome means to conquer. Prevail. It's from the Greek word nikao. Now, what does that mean for you? Well, how many of you ever wore a pair of Nike shoes or clothes? Nike means victory. And this word overcome is the verb form of Nike. It means victorious. So he who is victorious will inherit these things. You can be an overcomer in Christ. And if you are an overcomer in Christ because of your faith in Christ, you can inherit these things. John 16:33, Jesus says like this, these things I have spoken to you, so that in me, Jesus says, you may have peace. The world is going to give you tribulation. It's going to give you frustration. It's going to give you pain. Golly, talking about Christmas, I've seen more people get flipped off just in the past couple days at the mall than I've seen in a long time. People like, you know, parking, like, hey, cut me off, you know. I'm like, oh my goodness. I'm seeing people honk and yell at each other. I'm like, yeah, it's the most wonderful time of the year, you know. You know, it's like, wow. stay back. But the world's going to give you tribulation, but Jesus can give you peace. And Jesus says, take courage, because I have overcome the world. Jesus says, I will give you victory over the world. When the guy flips you off, or a guy cuts you off, or he takes your parking spot, and you can say, hey, that's not a big deal, because that's not what my life's about. Go ahead. I mean, if this is going to tweak your day, have at it. It's all yours. You know, I've overcome the world. I've got a bigger perspective than what this is. You know, when somebody rips you off in life, yeah, you're not going to be happy. You're not going to jump up and down, but you're going to say, I've got a bigger perspective, because God has given me a peace. And the next verse in your outline is incorrect because I typed it incorrectly. It, instead of Revelation 20:11, it should be Revelation 12:11. Revelation 12:11. So you might want to cross out the 20 and put 12:11. And when Jesus talks about us being overcomers, in Revelation 12:11, it says, and they, so this is right up on the screen, and they overcame him. And this is talking about the enemy. They overcame Satan and his forces because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of the testimony. And they did not love their life even when they faced death. You will overcome the enemy and the evil of this world because Jesus Christ's blood has all the power to protect you and give you authority over the evil one and to cleanse you from every guilt and every sin in your life. You can overcome guilt. You know, a lot of people are just, you know, they're toasted in life, in their heart, in their mind. Guilt creams them. Why does it cream them? Because they don't have freedom in Jesus Christ. They don't have freedom by the blood. And because they don't have freedom by the blood, they get depressed. And so they have to medicate their depression with something. And you know what? You can overcome that. When the world says you got to look like this, that, and this, you can say, you know what? I am complete in Christ. I am fully loved. I am fully accepted. I am fully cleansed. I am worthy. Is it because I'm so special? No, it's because of the blood of Christ that bought me and purchased me and gave me hope and gives me authority to say yes to the right things, say no to the wrong things, to recognize the enemy and say, I'm not going your way. I'm going towards a loving God that is going to give me the ability to overcome the garbage of this world. And so it's the blood of Christ, the blood of the Lamb, and the word of my testimony, which just says, I believe in the blood of Christ. So what does your word say? When people say, hey, what does so-and-so talk about? You know, what does Matthew talk about? When I hear Matthew talk, what am I going to talk about? You know, what does Ed talk about? When I hear Ed talking, is he talking about the blood of Christ? Is he talking about, you know, what's the words of his testimony? You know, is he talking about the Lakers and, you know, and kind of the weird stuff that he's got on? Or is he talking about the love of Christ? That's what we have. And when we overcome, when we have the victory that Jesus can give us, not in the Nike shoes or your Nike sweats, those aren't going to give you victory, but when you have the victory that Jesus gives you, then you will inherit all these things, all the blessings that we saw, the new works. And you will be, and God will be yours, and you will be his son or his daughter. There's a new inheritance. Now, unfortunately, along with the new inheritance, if you take the new inheritance, that's fantastic. But if you don't take that new inheritance, if you don't get connected to the Word of God and in the testimony, then there's new regret in verse 8. In verse 8, there's a new regret that says, but for the cowardly and the unbelieving and abominable and murderers and immoral persons and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars, their part will be in the lake that it burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. We can I can understand people that are horrible, murderers, immoral sorcerers, and idolaters. They're going to go to the lake of fire. I can understand that. But what about where it says the cowardly, the unbelieving, the liars? You know, if every one of us in here in this room were a little bit honest, maybe we don't fit into some of those other categories, but has there ever been a time where I've been cowardly? You know, maybe unbelieving? You know, maybe I've lied about who I am in before you. Cowardly means describing a person who loses their moral strength and courage. That means in the time when people say, do you believe in Jesus Christ? Do you believe that he died on the cross for you? People go like, oh, I don't know. And they kind of back down and then they kind of shake and they don't stand up for God. Well, at that time, they lose their moral strength and their courage. They need to follow Christ as Lord of their lives and say, He is number one. He's in charge. And you know what? They let their fears become their Lord. Because you know what? You and I all bow down to what is our Lord. Who's in charge? Well, that's what we bow down to. Do we bow down to a loving Savior in Jesus Christ? Or do I bow down to fear? Do I bow down to fear and say, no, I'm not going to stand up. I'm not going to stand up. The cowardly bow down to fear. And they're unbelieving. It means people without faith. They just don't have a clue. They don't believe at all. Liars, they're false and deceitful and untrue. Now, if I've been a coward one time, or if I've been unbelieving one time, or a liar, that doesn't mean I'm not going to heaven. I'm going to the lake of fire. This is talking about people that this is all their life is about. They're totally continuously unbelieving. They've always backed down from standing from God. They've lied all their life. This is a continual part of who they are, and we'll talk about that a little bit later in another passage. So we see that in the first 8 verses, and then there's a new Jerusalem. There's a new Jerusalem that we see here in the new heavens and the earth in verse 19 through 21. So there's a bride. We are part of that bride. It says, then one of the 7 angels in verse 9, who had the 7 bowls full of the 7 last plagues, came and spoke with me, saying, come here, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. The Lamb is Jesus. The bride is the church. That's who we are. And he carried me away in the spirits to a great high mountain and showed me a holy city, Jerusalem. That's where we're getting married, folks. Coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, her brilliance was like a very costly stone, as a stone of clear, crystal clear jasper. Christians who have died and go to the present heaven and presiding there will come down out of that present heaven into the new heaven and will brilliantly display with Christ in the new Jerusalem as part of the bride of the marriage supper of the Lamb. That's what we're talking about here in Revelation 21. And then the next part, we're just going to walk through some of this stuff, but there's the new Jerusalem has some major description of the walls and dimensions. It had a great and high wall, the 12 gates, and at the gates, 12 angels. And the names were written on them, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel. There were 3 gates on the east, and 3 gates in the north, and 3 gates in the south, and 3 gates in the west. And the wall of the city had 12 foundation stones, and on them were 12 names and 12 apostles. And the one who spoke with me had a gold measuring rod to measure the city and its gates and its wall. The city is laid out as a square, and its length is as great as its width, and he measured the city with a rod 1,500 miles. It'd be like from the Mexican border to the Canadian border. If you went straight from the Mexican border, straight up California through Oregon, Washington, that's to the Canadian border. That's about the length of what we're talking about in heaven here. And it's kind of like a big cube, so that's the length and the width and the height all together. And he measured its wall at 72 yards, you know, so that's how thick it is for human measures, but they're also talking about angelic measurements. What I want to point out here is God's most significant covenant-giving relationships. In the Old Testament, his most significant relationships was with the 12 tribes of Israel. They are going to form part of the memorial. And in the New Testament, it was the 12 apostles. So what happens is God's most significant covenant-giving relationships in the Old Testament, in the 12 tribes, in the New Testament, through the apostles, are going to be more memorialized in these gates and in the foundations of this city. Now, I'm not sure if this is going to be made available. I sent it out. But if you're in life groups here this week, I printed out some extra kind of things that talk about the dimensions of heaven. And so these can be made available to you. So here's some symbolic things that we just talked about that it goes through. And here's some dimensions that it looks like. It's not going to look exactly like this on the paper, but it's going to give you an idea of what all this means and kind of in what it might look like in a more picturesque aspect. The third thing in the New Jerusalem is the precious beauty. In verse 18 through 21, it says, the material of the wall was jasper, and the city was pure gold like glass, and the foundation stones of the city wall were adorned with every kind of precious stone. The first stone was of jasper, the second sapphire, the third, however you say that, the fourth, emerald, the fifth, sardonyx, the sixth, sardis, and seventh, chrysolite, eighth, beryl, ninth, topaz, tenth, chrysoprase. The 11th jacinth, 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each one of the gates was a single pearl. And the city of the street was pure gold like transparent glass. Man, this is pretty amazing stuff. Think of the biggest building you've ever seen that has just blew you away. Heaven is going to be like that. When it comes to the New Jerusalem, there will be no city that compares to the bling of the New Jerusalem. I mean, there's going to be gold, there's going to be all these jewels. And the amazing value of this city and its construction is only the beginning of how amazing its nature is. One of the things in verse 20, it talked about one of the fifth things in the foundation stone is sardonyx. Now, sardonyx comes from the onyx stone. And the onyx stone was originally in the Garden of Eden. In Ezekiel chapter 28, one of the things that what God asked the priest to do is on the priest's garments, he said, I want you to put these onyx or sardonyx stones, and I want you to have the 12 tribes of Israel on these stones. And what it does is it represents God's relationship with Israel and God's relationship with Eden. And so we're going to see that very same thing in the new heavens and the new earth. So it's hard to imagine what all this looks like, but it's going to be a pretty amazing place. And then we go to the glory of the holy city in verses 22 through 22:5. There's going to be a new temple in verse 22. It says, I saw no temple in it, for the Lord, the God Almighty, and the Lamb are its temple. When the Father and the Son are living among you. See, people come to a church, and I see this mistake happen a lot. People think God lives in this building, and he doesn't live out there. But where does he live? He lives in your heart. And wherever you go is where God lives, okay? And he lives in you. But some people think, oh, no, he just lives in this building. What happens is in the new heavens and new earth, he's going to live right among you. He's not only in your heart and his spirit is in your heart, he's going to live right among you. And so there's no need for church buildings because you're going to be right there in the presence of God. In verse 23 and 24, it says, the city has no need for the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of the Lord has illumined it. And its lamp is the Lamb. That means Jesus Christ, his glory will shine. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. In the Old Testament, Moses wanted to see God. God says, you can't handle it. You can't handle looking at me. Okay? And it's not because God was all that. I mean, you know, too prideful, but he was all that. And more, right? Because if Moses looked at God, it would just toast him. He says, you get to see my backside. So stick yourself in a crack, and as my backside goes past you, you'll see the backside of my glory. Now, that glory that made Moses' face shine is going to light up all of heaven all the time. How God's going to protect you and I from that? I mean, are we going to have special, like, 3D glory protection glasses? I'm not 100% sure. But it's going to be amazing, and it's going to light up heaven. And we're going to be able to see his glory, and it's not going to blow us away. It's not going to melt us because we're going to be in resurrected bodies, and we won't be like Moses. So the glory of God is going to be an amazing thing. And then the third thing we see here in verse 25 through 27 is it's going to be pure access in our connection with God. In the daytime, for there was no night there, the gates will never be closed. There's never going to be a time where we cannot get to God. And they will bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And nothing unclean, no one who practices abomination, lying, shall ever come into it, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The people in heaven will always have access to God. The gates are never going to close on you. Once you're in, you will always have access to God. Now, let's go back to this word practices, because it kind of goes before when we talked about the cowardly and lying. This word practice is a continual active word. It's an active participle. And it means you're never stop practicing. Now, you and I, does anybody here ever have a habit that they struggle with as far as sin besides me? Okay, thank you for being honest. And we think, golly, I just can't get out of this. And so I try and I confess my sin and God gives me power. And then what it used to happen every day maybe happens every other day. And then maybe happens every week. And then maybe happens every month. And now I'm growing and it's taking less and less time. I mean, more and more time between times. And so I'm growing on it. And some people think, oh gosh, I'm continually doing it. But you know what? That's not what this word practicing means. This word practicing, the people who practice the abomination lying, that means they don't try to stop. They don't ever try to stop. They never feel convicted. They never feel sorry for their sin. They're saying, yeah, this is what I do. I love to sin like this. And I'm not going to stop. In fact, why don't you come sin with me? That's what these people are. So when you and I sin, and we feel like, oh, man, God, I blew it. But God, please forgive me. I'm convicted. I want to change, and I change for a day or a week or a month. You know, I'm growing in that change. That's not the same thing as these people. Does that make sense? So if you are fully on embracing it and you're not ever trying to stop, then you're practicing. But if you're trying to stop and you feel convicted and the Holy Spirit says, hey, change this up, and you try and you get people to pray for you and you are trying to step away from that sin and you're trying to step in the right thing, then God says, hey, I'm working with you and I'm going to grow you in that grace. That's different from people who are saying, I totally embrace sin and this is what I do. That's what these people are doing right here. So letters, the third thing about this pure access is our entrance into the heaven. What does it say at this last thing? But only those names who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Our entrance into heaven is not based upon how good we are and what we do. It's based upon whether our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's the place where our names are recorded when we trust that Jesus Christ was the perfect sacrifice for us. When you say, I've got nothing. I've got nothing before a holy God except forgiveness. That's the only thing I got. We all need to come to that place in our life where we say, I've got nothing. I can't put enough money in the offering. I can't serve enough things. I can't help enough homeless people. I can't help enough old ladies across the street. I've got nothing when it compares to a holy God except the perfect sacrifice of Jesus Christ. When you come to that and believe in the Lamb of God, when you humble yourself to that point, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And then, after your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you know what you do? Then you're like, I am so motivated by God's love. I want to serve people. I want to help people. I want to help the homeless. I want to help the elderly. I want to do that, not to get to heaven, because I've gotten to heaven because of Christ. I do this because God has gotten me to heaven. You see the difference? Instead of trying to earn my way there by doing all these things and thinking, have I done enough? You never know, right? Have you done enough? If that's your game plan. But if your game plan is the cross, where you're fully accepted because the penalty has been paid in full, total, the debt is wiped out, because of Jesus Christ, then you don't do things to get to heaven. You do things because you've already gone to heaven. You're like, God, I'm so grateful, so I want to help. God, I'm so grateful, so I want to serve. God, I'm so appreciative, so I want to love. So we do it as a result, not to get to heaven. And that's because our name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that's the only way I'm going. And then we see in chapter 22, another description of the river of life. Chapter 22, verse 1 and in the second part of verse 2, it says, and then he showed me a river of water, showed me a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and in the middle of its street. Now, think about the cities you've been to that have a river running through the city. What color is that water? Brown, right? And what's floating in the water? Garbage, right? You know? And it's just, bleh, okay? But what do we got right here? We got a crystal clear river flowing from the throne of God. From the throne of God. There's no curse. There's no pollution. There's no waste. There's no dead bodies floating in the water. Okay? No gangsters have tried to put somebody at the bottom of the river. Okay? This is pure from God. That's what we have to look forward to. And then, in the second half of 22:2, it says, on the other side of the river was a tree of life. On the either side of the river was a tree of life. So now there's two trees of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. These trees of life are for the healing of the nations. Are you part of the nations? Yes, there's going to be healing in your life. There's going to be healing between nations. There's going to be healing for every person out of every nation. These trees of life, people that eat from them, but then there's going to be healing, and that's what God wants there. And then the next thing we see in 22 verse 3, it says there will no longer be any curse. There's going to be no effects of that curse either. The hard ground, you know, some of us like to do a little landscaping. Okay, when you landscape in the new heaven and new earth, it's not going to break your back. I talked to a guy today who ripped out some neighbor's weeds, and it just took him hours because it overgrown. In heaven, guess what? No weeds. Okay? It's not going to be busting your tail. There's no going to be thorns or thistles. The ground's not going to be hard. You're going to be gardening perfect ground. And that's going to, you know, and let me see. I don't know. Any moms in the room? Okay? Moms? Okay? Childbirth? Fun time? No? No? It just, I mean, it felt really good. It's like, hey, let's, you know. Meaningful, but hard. Okay. One of the curses in the fall was that pain increased greatly. Okay? Pain increased greatly. And we got some people who can give some testimony here. Okay? Those effects of sin will not be going on in heaven. And then in 22, verse 3 through 5, we're talking about the throne of God. It says, and the throne of God and the Lamb will be in it, and his bondservants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. We'll be marked people for God. And there will no longer be any night. They will not need to have light or lamp, nor the light of the sun, because the Lord will illumine them. Sounds like a group I know. And they will reign forever and ever. When we see God the Father, we will see God the Father and God the Son on the throne. We're not just going to hear about him, but we're going to actually see him on the throne. And then we will serve God as his identified children. He's going to mark us. Okay, we're going to be marked as his children. I mean, you know, I'm going to be proud to wear that mark. It's not going to be like wearing some gangster Laker shirt. I mean, it's going to be proud to wear the mark of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's what I'm going to be marked by. And then it says, God's glory in presence will illumine heaven. It's going to shine on heaven. Now, this word illumine right here really is where illuminate comes from. Let's talk about this a little bit. It is the verb form of to illuminate. What does illuminate mean? Illuminate means two things. Illuminate means to brighten with light. Okay, so, you know, if I got a flashlight and I flash it on, you know, that's part of that. And that's what the name of this group is we want to shine the light in the truth of God. We want to shine the light in the world. And then also illuminate means to enlighten spiritually or intellectually. I mean, when you come here to this group, you're hopefully being enlightened spiritually, right? You're seeing God's truth. You're seeing God's promises. And you're being enlightened intellectually. So in heaven is going to be illuminated both physically with the glory of God, but there won't be any need for lights. The glory of God is going to shine, and then heaven is going to be illuminated spiritually because of God's presence that's going to be here all the time in full array. There's not going to be any sin or deceit or worldly things that try to distract you away from the power of God. So just check this out. You think illuminates a cool place here on earth? It's going to be a full cool place in heaven because heaven is going to be illuminated by the glory of Jesus Christ. And you get to be there if you know him personally. And then the last thing we're going to look at is in 22:6. And he said to me, these words are faithful and true. And the Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, sent his angel to show his bondservants the things which must soon take place. So that's what he's saying, the Apostle John. You can take these words about heaven, just truth for your life. You can know what it's going to be like. The Bible has been tested. People have looked at this word and said, you know what, this word is full of junk. But people have tried to test it. When they come up with things that say, oh, this Bible is inaccurate because of this and this. Archaeology has been used to disprove some of the things that people say is wrong. They say, hey, these cities never existed. In Genesis, like I'll give you one example. In Genesis 14, they say, these cities never existed. In Genesis 14, they listed about five different cities. And so this is in the 1970s. Now, not many of you were around in the 1970s, but at least your parents were. I mean, I was around in the 1970s. So this is, you know, at least within the last century. Were you around in the 70s? No. Okay. So in the 70s, we got scholars, intellectual scholars saying, hey, the Bible's bunk because these cities never existed. Until in the 70s, some guys were doing some archaeology, and they found this kingdom of Ebla, and they found 14,000 tablets. Not just one, not 14, not 1,400, but 14,000 that talked about all this kingdom. And in one of the tablets, it had the same exact cities as in Genesis 14:6, with the same exact spelling in the same exact order. Okay, people who try to disprove this have come up against it, and they've seen, hey, this word is true, even though they try to disprove it wrong. And so when this Bible is talking about heaven, you can bank your life on this. Believers in the spiritual warfare life can bank on this. Now the question is, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ tonight, are you a spiritually committed overcomer? You know, we talked about those who are overcomers, they will inherit the kingdom, right? Are you a spiritually committed overcomer? Or are you somebody who rejects the truth and you're unbelieving and cowardly? That's where it comes down to. Are you a spiritually committed overcomer, or do you reject these things and are unbelieving and cowardly? And also, for those of you who have yet to believe, are you willing to put your trust in Jesus Christ and believe he paid for the sins of the world, including yours? And are you willing to take that forgiveness into your life and receive that grace that's going to get you into heaven so your name can be written in the Lamb's Book of Life? You can do that tonight. In fact, I want to lead you in a prayer that can help you do that right now. So would you pray with me? God, I thank you that in this war that we face, that's a spiritual war, we have everything at our disposal because you put it there first. It's not that we're so creative that we invented spiritual protection. You gave it to us fully in Jesus Christ. You sent angels to protect us in those things. Lord, that you give us the hope of heaven where the war will be over. God, we thank you that when we stand before you in heaven, there will be your glory, and your glory will be amazing. It will shine bright. There will not be any need for light. There will be no night. Lord, I pray for the Christians in here who know they need to be strong, who know that they need to step up and be spiritually committed overcomers, or that they're not going to back down. And Lord, if there's a believer in here that has kind of been backing down, I pray that you would strengthen them by your Spirit, that they wouldn't live cowardly, but they would live committed. Lord, that they would find encouragement and grace in you. And Lord, if there's somebody in this room who doesn't know they're going to heaven because they haven't fully trusted in you, Lord Jesus, I pray that they understand you paid the sins of the world in full on the cross. You've given us the privilege to receive that forgiveness as we trust in you. Lord, if there's somebody here that hasn't received by faith tonight, help them right now. And if you haven't trusted in Jesus Christ, you